God, we surrender our hearts, our lives, the emotions that says, I don't want to do it now. The temptations, Lord, I just surrender everything, God. There at the cross of Christ, I lay down the flesh so that before your throne, I can lay down the beauty that you've placed in me, the beauty that you are creating in me, to honor you with that, to bring you that what is precious, Lord, as we acknowledge you as the one in my life, Lord. Thank you for the privilege of knowing you. Thank you for the honor, Lord, that we can know your word, know you, Holy Spirit, here, even tonight, as you open it up for us, that we will see the beauty of the word of Christ. In Jesus' name, so we pray. Amen, amen. We can sit. Thank you. We are talking about the Acts of the New Testament church. We're talking about restoration of that. And I believe it's imprinted. It's there. It's in our hearts. It will go down into our feet so that we can walk it out. Amen. You can hear it, but it must go there in the heart. It must go from the heart. It must go to the feet so that we will walk the gospel. We will walk as the guys did in the book of Acts and even going beyond that. Hello? So that the works, as Jesus said, the works that I've done, you will do, and even greater works than the works that are written down in the Word of God. May God help us to be found faithful for such a calling in this season. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Okay, we're going to go with point number 6. Point number 1 was prayer, a main theme. Prayer as a main theme as we seek His will. Second one was precision in my life, because what? I study His word. I'm not just seeking His will, I'm studying His word. Precision. Hello. Are you with me? Third one, perspective. I have a certain perspective, eternal perspective about my past, my present, my future. I have a perspective of what is of value and what is not valuable. I can understand. I have an understanding of what is valuable and what not. My opinion is valuable. No, His opinion is valuable, and that what He wants to give to me is awesome, awesome, awesome. If I can understand that what He wants to give to me and don't mess it up, because it's beautiful. Hello, that was number 3, as far as I know. Number 4 was the preaching through your lifestyle, preaching as part of your life, not when you are standing on a platform and get a deep voice, "Thus saith the Lord," but through your lifestyle, through what you say. In the New Testament church, it was part of how they lived. It was not a special moment. It was, they shared what was inside. If the people said, "You're not allowed to speak," they said, "Well, we need to obey God." And God said, "Speak." God said, "Speak." So there where you are, make sure that Christ is coming through in what you say. That was number 4. Number 5, power, because of God's enablement. Amen? Power, because of God's enablement. Number 6, today, provision. Provision. Okay. God will always have provision for you, because He's an awesome, excellent Father. Awesome, excellent Father. And He's an awesome, excellent Father. If you can remember that, you can go now. Awesome, excellent Father. That's your Father. We go with a few, what do you call those things? Acronyms. Donkey. Okay. My provision. Everybody say my provision. Praise the Lord. First one with M. Now you're supposed to know, because you had the Afrikaans. My 5,000 rand still stands. M. So you had it this morning. Nobody can find the M. So it's as easy as fall out of a tree. Okay, there it goes. Make known your requests. Openbaar jou behoeftes. Make known your requests. Matthew 5, 41 and 42. 5:41-42. And whoever compels you to go 1 mile, go with him too. Give to him who asks you, and from him who wants to borrow from you, do not turn away. It's very easy to say, okay, I will give you, but then I think I'm really doing you a favor. But if God says you're supposed to give, but they're supposed to ask. No, guy out there asking for money. Most probably he messed up his life. You know, he's too lazy to work. He doesn't want to work. Yeah, we are so easy to judge the people that does not have. We say, no, those guys that stand like this. No. Some other rubbish in their lives. And it's not that we will easily just give them. When you give to the poor, you give unto the Lord. You borrow. As jy aan die arme gee, gee leen jy aan die Here. Anybody to translate that one? When you give to the poor, you borrow unto the Lord. And in our giving, I need to let go of my pride. I need to let go of my pride to say, I have this need. I have this need. God will challenge you in how to give yourself and how to surrender yourself, but you're supposed to make it known. Carry one another's burdens. So that means I need to carry your burden, but that means you must open up the fact that you have a burden. Are you with me? So that is supposed to be there. 1 Corinthians 12, you can write that. Maybe you've written it this morning already. 1 Corinthians 12, the one part of the body cannot say to the other one, because you're not like me, I don't need you. Everybody needs one another in the body of Christ. You don't have to be like the other one, but you need him. No, I'm working hard. Tutuf, 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 tutuf. Oh, I'm the heart. And that lazy guy, he's like, what a lazy guy. He's part of the lung, you know. If the lung must go to you the whole time, the guy will hyperventilate and he will crack up, man. Are you with me? Let us not be confused in the body of Christ, but understand each one has a different role to play, and how can we respect the role that each one needs to play? But how are we codependent? How are we depending on one another? And how do we need one another in the body? Do your own thing. You don't understand the body of Christ. No. Do your own thing. That's bad. That's all I say. Number two. Why? Yield to his plans. Yield to his plans. Hello? How many times? Yield to his plans. If you, then I will. If you obey my commandments, then this. If you obey my commandments and follow me. If you are diligent, if you will obey everything. God says even to Joshua, you're going to take the land. If you obey me, then it will happen. No, that's not manipulation. That's a principle. That's a principle. This is the way we will do it. If you obey me, then I will. Because I don't want to just give it to you and there you go. If you obey me, it means you come close to me. You come close to me and then I will give you the land. But then it's me and you crossing the Jordan. It's first the ark, there the priest will stand, and then everybody will go through, and then the ark will come, and my presence will go with you. If you, then I will. But that if you obey, if you take, if you keep, if you have faith, if you are faithful, if you stand on my promise, it's all about what? Coming close, coming close, coming close, coming close, coming. And because God wants to give you the breakthrough, but no breakthrough without him. Because at the end of the day, he is your breakthrough. There's breakthrough guys in the world can have, and they can curse the name of Christ. And they can have a lot of things. Oh, and they have a lot of success. There's one type of breakthrough you have, and that is to cross the Jordan with Christ. To cross the Jordan with him. That is why it's conditional. That's why with a murmuring in the desert, and at the last time that they murmured and said, fire Moses, and kill Joshua and Caleb, and let's go back. That's the place for provision. We're talking about provision, not true? Yield to his plans in there. In that place, the provision will be. Even in the provision, I see giants. No, the giants are, they are our provision, Joshua Caleb says. They are our food, they said. Not cannibals, but we're going to learn from that. We're going to benefit from the giants. There's going to be some testimony. There's going to be something excellent happening. When there's these intimidating situations over your life, make ready for a miracle. There's something amazing going to happen. When you stand in financial turmoil, when you're standing in financial situations that you want to become depressed or negative, no. You're going to have a certain breakthrough. Something excellent is coming. Joshua and Caleb said that. They brought the fruit. Look at the fruit, man. Here's the proof of God's promises. Here's the proof about what God has promised us. Hello? You are still with me? Okay. God will provide for you the fruit of the land and the giant. The giant is your food. Okay, don't eat the thing. But you're going to learn from it. You're going to find faith. They found a lot because they saw every giant, everything, every strong city wall that just fell. Boom, 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 boom. The one after the other one. The battle belongs to the Lord. They saw, man, really, the battle was the Lord's in every situation. Far greater than any giant. And it was food for their spirit, food for their faith, food for their testimony, food for their courage, food for their perspective of who is this awesome God. Inside it was a strength that stood up. Is food not to strengthen you? Okay. At least do this, not please. Goed, ons is met mekaar. I believe so. Yield to his plans. P. Oh, that's very obvious. My provision. Pray. Pray. We see that in Matthew 7, verse 7. 7-7. You will remember 7-7. Not the casino's 7-7-7, but the scripture of 7-7. You stop with the second 7. Okay? Ask and keep on asking, and it will be given to you. Keep Knock and keep on knocking, and you will be able to enter. Seek and keep on seeking, and you will find. That's in the Amplified, what it means in the Greek. So when you pray, you will receive. God says that's how it will be. But it's all depending on how you pray. Why must you pray, God, give us today our daily bread? As if God is saying, I'm not going to give you your daily bread unless you ask. You're telling your child, and you experienced in your house when you were young, a younger, that if you didn't ask for food, your parents said you will not get food tonight because you didn't ask. Who will do that? So why must we ask for our daily bread? Because God wants us to position ourselves in dependency on him, because prayer is positioning. In prayer, I position myself. In prayer, I choose to be dependent on him. So pray this. Pray that, give us today our daily bread. How often must you pray that? Every day? If he's saying, give us today, then the prayer is for today. Not true? So tomorrow, if you must pray for today, then in that day you pray that prayer that day. We're all finding the logic of that. What is it saying? Make sure that in your prayer, every day you position yourself before God to say, I'm dependent on you. I'm dependent on you. In prayer, I pray because I'm dependent on you. I declare that I will be dependent on you. That's it. That's it. Then even in this, we see what kind of father is there that when the child will ask for bread, he will give a stone. What is he saying? Even in the in the bread that we receive, Jesus said, man will not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Amen. What is the daily bread? God said, eat the word. Don't get freaky, but eat the word. You understand what it says. I am the bread of life. Eat from me. Hello? What is he saying? The word that you must receive must have substance for you to live according to that word. But the Father will not give the stone. What is the stone? The stone is the religion. The stone is the religion. Hello? That want to kill. So I can give. We can. It's the letter that kill. The word. It's the letter that can. This can be a very hard stone that can kill. All around can kill, can kill, can kill. But with the Holy Spirit, it's coming alive and it's bread. That's what God wants to do by the Holy Spirit. Hello? Make sure that what you speak is not throwing stones, but that you are giving life to people because of what you give them. The way that you speak, what do you give the people? Okay, that was the second one. If you are a good father, how will you? If your son asks you bread, you will give him a stone? No way. And the second one was, if you ask him, if you ask me for fish away, will the father give him a snake? Let's do that again. What did we say this morning? When the child asks for a fish, will he give him a snake? No. You don't find that father. In the fish, it's there as a provision. We see the fish in the context many times in the word symbolizes provision. Even like the goue kreerant. What was that goed geweest in the fish for the to pay Caesar? There was some money in the mouth of the fish. Even the 5 loaves of bread and the 2 fish. The 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish for the 5,000 people, for the 7,000 people, always provision. Oh, fish. Well, okay, the net is too heavy because of all the provision that came in. God just blessed on your word, I will go again. Second time that miracle, and it happens again. Okay, let's leave that one there. He will not give you a snake. Don't not give you the provision that will destroy you. Provision that will be poison. There's provision that will be poison. There's provision that will be a curse in your life. And you will try through this opportunity. You have this talent and you can do this work and you like this type of work. And with all these things, you can do all these things. And yay, there's provision. But if it wasn't God's will for you to do that, that's going to be a snake that will you. That snake will get you. But now it's nice. It's nice snake meat. You don't even know it's snake meat. Nice provision. There's poison in that provision. And last one, what it says there, what child is there that will ask a father an egg and the father will give him a scorpion? It's provision. But at the end of the day, poison will come here from the back. There will be poison in the provision. God is not such a father. And then he says, if a father that has a lot of mistakes, if a father with sin, if a father with a lot of faults, a lot of things, will not do that, how much more me as your perfect father, God says, will I give the Holy Spirit? The Holy Spirit. But we were not talking about the Holy Spirit. But in the Holy Spirit, there's all the provision. Because Holy Spirit will guide you there. Holy Spirit will guide you in this. Holy Spirit will guide you in that. His guidance will be there. And through Him, you will have everything. Where the word says, when I have Him, I have everything. Why? If you have Christ, then you have everything. That sounds spiritual, but it's very super spiritual. Very super spiritual if you're not practical with the Holy Spirit. But you've been given everything when you are guided by the Spirit. Because He will show you and bring you into places where you will stand amazed at the provision coming from your Father. It will be there. It will be there. Appreciate His presence. appreciate his presence. That's the biggest, awesome provision of your life. And that is the presence of the Holy Spirit in, through, with, over, in front, behind you. That is the absolute of provision. That makes you different than any other person on this earth. You as a child of God. Please remember that one. Number four. Respect God with your tithes and your offerings. Malachi 3 verse 8 to 12. You got it this morning, some of you. And tonight as you hear it again, I'm sure Holy Spirit is speaking to you now about what you've heard this morning and how to go and deal further with this. I challenge you as a leader, and you as a student, you're supposed to do that. When you've heard it before, you're supposed to ask in Holy Spirit, then what do you want to say me about what I have heard? Respect God with your tithes and your offerings. Why? You respect him because you will not steal from him. When you go into a house and you steal, at least the guy is not there. You make sure the person is not there and you go and you steal so that you are safe. But you know, if the owner of the house is there and you come in, you know he's sitting there right in front of you. You ignore him. And you just walk around and you take his things and you steal it and you just go out. What freak show. God is in the house. God is in your life. The tithing and the offering belongs to him. You know that tithing, it's not like a law, first of all. It's an honor. You honor God with your tithing, your offering, because you will not steal from him. It's so disrespectful if you will just take from him whatever you want. That belongs to him. It's his. Hello? Oh, but it's not under the law. No. The tithing is before the law. It came from Abram according to the order of Melchizedek. And in Hebrews we see Jesus is from that order. Not from the priestly order that was fulfilled. That was fulfilled when Christ became the lamb. The priestly order where the lamb was sacrificed. And there all the sacrifices made. At the end of the day, he became the lamb. But he also became the high priest. And then Paul says he is priest according to the order of Melchizedek. And Abram gave as a place and into a place of honor he gave the high priest. The 10%. That was a principle. That tithing. What will be the problem in that? I think one of the most, according to me, is to keep our heart clean. To keep our heart clean and to thank God for what he has given us. For what he has given us. Put your heart in it. Don't make it a law. But if it's a law to you, just repent. And then it becomes an act of love and respect. Amen? You with me? Okay, I believe so. Operate responsibly in your job, in your work. Whatever you do as if unto the Lord. You have a job, you have some work. And that, with that job, with that work, it's just part of God's provision. Your salary, the wages that you receive at the end of the month, it's just a little part of your salary. It all depends how you live and by what principle you live in your heart, in your mind, in your walk, in your dealings with God and people around you. God will give you creative ideas and he will do exceedingly abundantly above all that you think or pray, if you can understand that. But also in your job, the worker is worthy his wages. You with me? James 5 verse 4. Remember that one? James 5 verse 4. Oh, I wonder you, it will be wonderful if you can speak more. Are you with me? Okay. Operate responsibly in your job and in your work. The my guy with the one talent, the two talent, the five talents, oh, we've spoken about that enough. Responsibility is what? not when people need to check you up. When somebody needs to check you up that you are doing your schoolwork. When people need to check you up that you study. You see, that guy busy on his phone. Yeah, Creator, you know? Is he busy studying? Is he taking notes? Or what is he doing right now? Is he faithful or is he a faithful servant? Is he responsible for his life with Christ? No. He's just wara wara. And all that he can become is a wara wara. So that the devil can laugh at him. No. But what will you do? Faithfulness is determined when people are not watching. When it's not, you're not told, do your work. Come and do your work. Do know your werk. Come and study. Focus. Give attention. When the leader gave the one, the two, the five talents, and he left. Then act responsibly in your work. That will be tested. And the guy with a responsibility in here, not out of performance, not out of fear. But what he had, it was duplicated. Five became ten. You're only faithful, not if you keep what he has given you and bring it back to him. No, only if it multiplied, then you are faithful. With that, what you have in your life, if it's not multiplying, you're not faithful. You're not faithful. You're not act with responsibility in the job and in the work. Now I do everything that they expect me to do. I'm a servant. I'm laying down my life. What a fool. Not one of you. But if you understand how to act responsibly with your work as if unto the Lord, then what you have, God will honor you and it will duplicate. God will bring the growth. Five will become ten. It will happen because God is a faithful God. But act responsibly. Why? Because you will honor him. You will do what you do as if unto the Lord. As it is an honor for you to work. Why? Work was created by who? God. God, on the first day, he worked. Second, worked. Three, four, five, sixth day, he worked. On the seventh day, he rested. And Jesus, today, our Sabbath rest. Still, we must rest, definitely. But at the end of the day, yes, Ephesians, like we said this morning, everybody remember Ephesians what? Thank you very much. 2, verse 10, that says, we are God's workmanship. We are the result, the product of his work. Of his work. There's a certain excellence in his work. And the product of the excellent work that he did, you were created to do what? Also to work. You are his excellent workmanship, created to do the work that God has prepared for you to do. So there's a work that we call a curse, call a slavery, because we don't do it as if unto him. If you do it for the money, that money as a slave will come back to you. He as a curse will come back to you to enslave you. If it's not for you, it will be for your children to be enslaved. But the curse will come for you or your children or your grandchild. The curse on the money that you brought in through the act of slavery and how you did your job and you saved some money, maar jy het jou vrek gewerk and what you did, just what you're supposed to do. What do you have in your hand? Curse is that thing. You're going to give that curse thing to your child. If he's not working you, he's going to work in your child. Or you're going to see it as an honor. And you're going to work because God created you to work. And you want to become like him, and because he is a God that works. Jesus says, I'm working and my Father is also working still. See it as an honor. And if you do it in the right way, what you do will multiply. You will not get vrek gewerk. What's vrek in English? Dood is die. Vrek is what? What is vrek? I thought I heard something. Okay, whatever. You're with me still? I hope so. I believe so. Number six.
Sing the promises you speak. Let it be done to me.
But with a myth attitude, when the day of breakthrough will be there, you will miss it. You will miss it. No, man. No, we will not long at the day of breakthrough for the place of slavery. And the food that we had in the place of slavery. No, in Jesus' name, God will help us in that. In Jesus' name. Number seven, I intercede for other people's needs. We see that in the book of Acts, there was intercession. They just interceded for the other people. They just brought the healing. They were constantly in prayer, fervently in prayer. They gave themselves in prayer for the birthing. Intercession has to do with the birthing. When you are not in prayer just before the Lord, but before the Lord in prayer where heaven and earth meets together and something is birthed. And that facet of where not just be before the Lord and bring everything before Him in prayer, but where there's such a connection that something is birthed, we call that intercession. Bring that for other people and their needs. We see that with Job, remember? Job, miserable, sitting there. Wife says, man, curse God and die. Because he's so miserable, that's the counsel from his wife. And at the end of the day, God says, pray for your friends. God says, pray for your friends. And then everything changed in his life. When you can look away from yourself. When you can go and look away from yourself. So many breakthroughs can come to you. Number six. S. Everybody must know that one. S, that stands for? So. Hallelujah. Deep revelation. So. 2 Corinthians 9. What you sow, you will mow. That what you sow, you will reap. Hey? 2 Corinthians 9, verse 6 and 7. But this, after he's saying that you must sow ready, you must be ready as a matter of generosity and not as a grudging obligation. But this I say, he who sows sparingly, biki fa biki, will also reap sparingly. Yesala use biki fa biki. A harvest, just a little by little. And he who sows bountifully, that's a word that says a lot, okay, will also reap bountifully a lot. You understand? So let each one give as he purposes in his heart. From your heart, not from your head, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, towards you, that you always having all sufficiency in all things may have an abundance for every good work. Abundance so that you can just have abundance. No. Abundance for every good work. Abundance so that you can do something with it. Abundance so that He is giving you, when He's giving you the million or the billion, you're supposed to work with it. What? So that it will become double. 2 billion. No. so that you understand how this billion must be for the kingdom. But you won't believe when finances will come into your hand, how suddenly your heart can change. Suddenly you see things a little bit different. When I had this salary of 2,000 and I bought the house by miracle, and the house bond was 3,000 a month, and the house bond is supposed to be a third of your salary, but the bank was blind. I don't know what happened there. But for 3,000, you need to have a salary of 9,000. My salary was 2,500. Hallelujah. And the year after that, they approved for a second house, for another 3,000 bond on my 2,000, I think, 800 salary, not 500 anymore. Something like that. Oh, that's God, man. That is really only God. How can we, God, show us, we're going to plant a church? I scream in the car. I said, God, where are we going? And immediately God said, this place. Before I got into the street from that church where we were planted from, God said, this place, not for sale. Long story short, after 6 months, 5.5 months, then the pastor found, no, you can have the church. Oh, 2.4 in the market just before that. We buy it at 1.5. 900,000 less. Boom. That's just God, man. Laughing at the farm. Boom. Just get the whole farm for free. And when you share this testimony, when I share this with the guys that are out in the world, you know, I just love it to look at their faces. And I can just say, this is God, man. And this is what God wants to do for you. And da, 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 da. Are you with me? God wants to give you amazing testimonies that you need to share out there. You need to share out there about the goodness of your Father, the goodness of your God, and how He provides for you. But that's in the sowing. Sowing not to manipulate, but sowing to be like Him. God loves a cheerful giver. When you do that with excitement, why? Because then you are becoming like Him. And He loves Himself. He's the essence of love. He cannot but love Himself. And that's what He's saying to you. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. Why will God expect that if He's not doing it with Himself? God loves Himself with Himself because He's love. Are you with me? So when you become a cheerful giver in what you give, yes, then it's great because you become like your Father. God is excited. Is it not saying in Hebrews 12 verse 2 that for the joy set before Him, Jesus went to the cross. For the joy set before Him, He gave His whole life as a joy. And the scriptures say there's joy in the offering. First 6 months of Creare, when I started with the classes, then 7 o'clock we start with classes, and about 10 o'clock, half past 10, I'm finished. Half an hour break, 1 o'clock, and maybe an hour break between 6 and 7. Then run like 4 or 5 kilometers to find some food or whatever, because, yeah, forget about the rest. Because the petrol, it's not there. And so that happened for a while. And then I would be going to a certain place, and I need, after 6 months, the whole 6 months of giving karate classes, I think it added up to 3,000 or 4,000 rand for the 6 months. Yes, I need all of that, and then I'm going to visit my sister in Holland. So my dad, mum will pay, but I must have money there to live. And I said, what am I going to do in Holland? Phone YWAM. YWAM, yes. What are you doing in that town? No, we have an outreach in Romania. I'm going with. Great, great. Afterwards. Where's Romania? But it was an excellent time. But when I wanted to receive the money, there was financial problems in the church. So the pastor told me, no, we needed the money to pay the salaries of the pastors. These classes, I didn't even have to pay in at the account of the Bible school. I don't have petrol money, so I'm walking from the church to there. What's that hyper pick and pay thing? Not the far one at CRC, the other one. You call that the what one? Pick and pay hyper. Walk there, it's like, I don't know how many kilometers, 2, 3, 4. And I'm walking back and I'm saying, God, this is not right. This is not right. Not strike them, Lord, but God, this is not right. And you know what the Lord said? As I went over that bridge, I will never forget that bridge. When I go there, every time I'll remember that. You know that bridge, when you cross the bridge and there's the hospital, University's Hospital, when you come back? Okay, just forget it. When I walked up, God said, if you will not receive the money, will you still develop the people for me? And then there was silence between me and the Lord. And I was counting the lamping poles, I remember. It's one, and then two, and I was and yeah, I went only after the breach down and had to turn. I said, yes, Lord, I will develop them for you. But then I realized, this is not finished, my brother. I need to say that until there's joy in the offering. I had to say it about 50 times. Are you with me? Until it was, yes, thank you, Lord, for the honor that I can develop the students in drama. I gave drama classes and even evaluated the dance and the music classes and perspective and whatever theory. And all. I will develop them for you even if I get nothing. So it took a while, but after a while, saying that 20, 30, 40 times. And when I got to my room, there was a check with all the money. Oh, God, He will sort you out. He's jealous for your love. He's jealous. I'm your provision. God says, I'm your provision. You with me? But it was not so lekker. That die bridge, I will never forget the bridge. There must be joy in the offering. You moan and groan, you curse your harvest. You curse your harvest. The devil is not involved, man. He's not even involved. He's just thinking, what a fool. Not one of us anymore, in Jesus' name. Okay, number 9. Identify your priorities. Matthew 6:33. Identify your priorities. Seek first the kingdom of God, and then all the rest will follow. So, I seek the kingdom, clickety-click, and I watch. Yeah, the rest is coming. No, rubbish. You seek the kingdom, that means you want to know what the king is saying. In every situation, you want to know, what is the king saying? What is the king saying in this situation? And if I understand what the king is saying in this situation, the rest will follow. Whatever God wants to give to me, whatever he wants to surprise me with, that will be it. But for me, the provision is the essence of life is to follow the king and to make known what the king is saying wherever I go. That is seeking his kingdom. Amen. Sort out your priorities. Look your brother in the eye next to you and let your eyes tell him, sort out your priorities. Okay. Give that straight look. Okay. In love. Open your hand. Number 10. You have an open hand to receive. Only you cannot receive only if you've opened your hand. You remember the story that I told 25 times about the baboon? In the DVD, Beautiful People, how if the one man living there in the desert, if he wants to find some water, he make a hole in an anthill some other hill. But he's waiting for the baboon first to be there. And then he puts some pips, seeds, in there. A lot. The baboon is watching. But the baboon is very inquisitive. And he knows that. Those guys know, they know the animals. And then he will sit somewhere at the side. And then the baboon comes. And you must watch that movie. True story. And put in his hand. He took the pups. And then the guy come and catch the baboon. But the baboon is going crazy. But he does not know. He must just release the pips. Then his hand will be free and he can go. But he's too stupid to understand he must let go. Some people, nobody here, is too stupid to realize I must forgive. I must release the bitterness. I must release the issue. I must release that haha, whatever I want. I must release this. He did this to me or she did this to me. Even the fear, I cannot trust people. You cannot trust people. And I keep that thing. I'm not giving myself to other people because something happened at home when I was young. And for the next 50 years, you will go crazy like that freakazoiki baboon. Because you cannot let go. So the baboon cannot let go. And then he bind him at the tree, give him a lot of salt. The baboon eat the salt. You know, he's crazy about salt. And the man waits. And then he cuts him loose. And the baboons will not go to the place where they find their water. They are too clever because then the other animals will drink all the water. But then he runs straight to the water because he's been given all this salt. See, he is as thirsty as can be. He runs straight to the water. And the guy... I can't remember what. It's not the bushman. After him, phew, they find the water. Oh man, that's clever. But hopefully, you and me, we are not the baboon going crazy there. But we cannot understand, we must release. If we cannot release, we cannot receive. If you don't have an open hand, how can you receive from God? But the only way you open is because God give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. But if he has given you seed, you need to sow it. What type of crazy farmer will eat the seed? He will have no harvest. Even he doesn't know Christ. He's foolish in a lot of things. At least he will know. I cannot eat the seed. I must plant the seed. But then we have some whatever we have, and we like the prodigal son, and not we were, maybe sometime. And we eat it all up, the provision, and we enjoy today. But what was supposed to be seed? To be sown somewhere, sown in that ministry, sown in the ministry. I'm not talking about the tithings and the offerings. And God will surprise you. Open hand. Everybody do this. When I do that, let it go. Okay. Some guys were with me. The rest, I bless you in Jesus' name with repentance and the fire. Oh, not one of you guys. Number 11, name the source of your provision. Name the source of your provision. God is the El Shaddai, the one that is more than enough. Remember, that's what it means. El Shaddai. Jehovah Jireh, the God that provides. Jehovah Jireh, the God that provides. He's the good shepherd. He's the good shepherd. And then Romans 8, verse 32. Also, it says, if God is for me, who can be against me? And then he says, the God who has given me Christ, how will he not also with Christ give me everything that I need? But he does not want to give me everything that I need if it's not first priority, Christ. He wants to give me Christ. And when Christ is in the center, and Christ is the center of what he has given me, and I honor him, and I'm thankful for Christ as the center, with him, he also will give me everything that I need. Because the one that he has given me He's faithful. He's there to surprise me. He wants to surprise me. God wants to surprise you in such awesome, pleasant, beautiful ways. Make him the center of your life in every way. In every way. And it will not be a clickety-click. It's not, I will follow the shepherd. Follow the shepherd, I shall not want. That means in a freak show, no. I follow the shepherd. I'm not looking at the green pastures and ask the shepherd to come and bless me. Lord, here in this, here's the green pastures. Open up the door for me, please, Lord. Here's the goodness and mercy that will not follow me. I will look for it. Please, Lord, come and give me that and that and that and that. You follow the shepherd. You follow the shepherd. Goodness and mercy will look for you. God's blessing, God's provision will look for you. Where are you? Where are you? I need to be in your life. Provision says, I need to be in your life. Blessing says, I want to be in your life. Not talking about Dune. Okay. Are you with me? And at the end of the day, I still say, Father has given. The concept of giving is an act of love. The concept of giving so that there's provision for everything. God has provided for humanity not to go and have hell and rot and die for eternity burning in hell, where death will keep on for eternity. No, he has provided. And provision has given us hope. And the provision is in Christ, his Son. For God so loved the world, he so placed his heart in the giving. His whole heart was in the giving. He loved us so much that he gave. That he gave his only begotten Son. So the beauty of giving is in the center of the gospel. In the center of the gospel. Father didn't force me. I'm laying down my life out of my own because it's my choice, because I want to, Jesus said. He's giving his life because he wants to. Not because he was forced by the Father, the word says, Jesus said. God help us so that we can become like you. Lord, we want to be more and more like you, Lord, because eternal life is knowing you. God, you have a desire for us to become more like you. God, because you love yourself and you enjoy yourself, Lord, and you want to love us and enjoy us even more with us becoming more like you. Oh, God, help us to see that. Help us to understand these patterns, Lord. These patterns established in the New Testament church, but even more in this season, you want to establish it in our lives for the season, for the revival like never before on earth since the coming of Christ that will come in this season. Lord, laying ahead, help us not to be foolish virgins, Lord, but to be wise in how we present ourselves to you, to be changed, Lord. Thank you for your provision. Thank you for your provision in every facet. And that you've provided for us, not just in the physical, but with brothers and sisters, with family and friends, Lord, and with the capacity to know your word. We honor you for that, Father, in the essence that you've given your Son, Jesus Christ. Jesus, that you've given yourself. Holy Spirit, that you are faithful to be with us until the coming of Christ. Thank you, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, so we pray. Amen, amen, amen. May you awesomely be protected in his love, my brother, my sister. Please work through these things and see what God